Hi everyone, and today we are going to read the chapter The Lost Child from your book Moments, written by Mulk Raj Anand. This chapter is based on the theme of a strong bond between children and parents. In this chapter, the protagonist or the main character, the child, gets lost in the fair and he loses his parents there. What happens when he loses his parents and what feelings does he get when he realizes that he's all alone and insecure? Let's read this chapter today. I'll explain it and at the end of the session, we will do question answers as well. So let's begin with The Lost Child, written by Mulk Raj Anand. And before I begin with the reading and explanation, let me tell you something about the author first. Mulk Raj Anand was born on 12 December 1905 in Peshawar, Pakistan. He was an Indian writer in English, notable for his depiction of the lives of the poorer castes in traditional Indian society. He became known for his protest novel, Untouchable in 1935, Coolie in 1936, Two Leaves and a Bud in 1937. He was one of the first writers to use Punjabi and Hindustani idioms into English. He received International Peace Prize in 1953, Padma Bhushan in 1968, and Sahitya Akademi Award in 1971. He died on 28 September 2004 at the age of 98 in Pune, Maharashtra, India. A child goes to a fair with his parents. He is happy and excited and wants the sweets and toys displayed there. But his parents don't buy them for him. Why then does he refuse when someone else offers them to him? Now let's read the story. It was the festival of spring. From the wintry shades of narrow lanes and alleys emerged a gaily clad humanity. Wintry means cold. Alleys are narrow passages. Gaily clad humanity means cheerful group of people. Some walked, some rode on horses, and others sat, being carried in bamboo and bullock carts. One little boy ran between his father's legs, brimming over with life and laughter. Brimming over means filled up. Come, child, come, called his parents, as he lagged behind, fascinated by the toys in the shops that lined the way. Lagged means delayed, and fascinated means attracted. He hurried towards his parents, his feet obedient to their call, his eyes still lingering on the receding toys. Lingering means staying. Receding means moving back. As he came to where they had stopped to wait for him, he could not suppress the desire of his heart. Even though he well knew the old, cold stare of refusal in their eyes. I want that toy, he pleaded. Pleaded means begged. His father looked at him red-eyed, in his familiar tyrant's way. Tyrant is a cruel person. His mother, melted by the free spirit of the day, was tender and giving him her finger to hold, said, Look, child, what is before you? It was a flowering mustard field, pale like melting gold as it swept across miles and miles of even land. The story is set in the spring season. As the winter season had just ended, all the people came out of their houses. They were cheerful as the chilling cold weather had ended. People conveyed through different modes or they traveled through different modes like on foot or horses, bamboo carts and bullock carts. And there was this little child who was accompanied by his parents. He ran excitedly and often banged into his father's legs. He was so full of life, excitement and laughter because he was excited to go to that fair. The child was attracted to the toys which were displayed at the various stalls. As he would be left behind, his parents would call him to come with them. The child was obedient and would walk towards them on being called, but his eyes would keep on looking at the toys that he wanted. And as he reached them, he couldn't control his desire to buy a toy. So he begged his father to buy a toy for him. But the father was a very strict person. He looked at him with red eyes and denied or refused to buy him the toy. Just then, the gentle mother caught hold of his finger and she tried to distract him by showing him a field which was full of yellow flowers. It was a mustard field, and that field looked like melting gold as it swept across miles and miles of even land. That is, the field was so big, it was so vast, that with those yellow mustard flowers, it looked like melting gold. A group of dragonflies were bustling about on their gaudy purple wings. Bustling means buzzing, and gaudy means overbright. Intercepting the flight of a lone black bee or butterfly in search of sweetness from the flowers. Intercepting means blocking. The child followed them in the air with his gaze. Gaze means stare. Till one of them would still its wings and rest, and he would try to catch it. But it would go fluttering, flapping up into the air when he had almost caught it in his hands. Then his mother gave a cautionary call. Cautionary means a warning call. Come, child, come. Come on to the footpath. He ran towards his parents gaily and walked abreast of them for a while. Gaily means happily. Abreast means side by side. Being, however, soon left behind, attracted by the little insects and worms along the footpath that were teeming out from their hiding places to enjoy the sunshine. Teeming out means being full of. Come, child, come. His parents called from the shade of a grove. A grove is a group of trees where they had seated themselves on the edge of a well. He ran towards them. A shower of young flowers fell upon the child as he entered the grove, and forgetting his parents, he began to gather the raining petals in his hands. But lo, he heard the cooing of doves and ran towards his parents shouting, "The dove! The dove!" The raining petals dropped from his forgotten hands. "Come, child, come!" they called to the child, who had now gone running in wild capers. Capers means a dance or a kind of skip. Round the banyan tree and gathering him up, they took the narrow, winding footpath which led to the fair through the mustard fields. When the family reached the field, or it was crossing the field, there was a group of dragonflies, black bees and butterflies which buzzed around and which attracted the child a lot. The child even tried to catch one of those insects, but as soon as it caught it, the mother told him to come onto the footpath to walk. And so, forgetting about the insects or those bees, he ran towards his parents happily and started to walk side by side. And then soon he got attracted to little insects and worms along the footpath. So he forgot about the bees and he was interested in insects and worms. Again the parents called him to be with them. And then they all sat on the edge of a well. The child ran towards them. There was a shower of flowers which fell on him. He got so busy in collecting the petals and he heard about the cooing of doves. Suddenly, the petals in his hands fell on the ground, and he was again interested in the sound of the doves. The parents again called him to come with them, and now he was running in wild capers, that is, dancing merrily and skipping around merrily around the banyan tree. And then finally he joined them when they were walking through a footpath which led to the fair through the mustard fields. So this part of the story tells us that the child was easily distracted to other things, and when he got distracted to other things, he could easily forgot what he had seen or what he was interested in the earlier thing. Let's read ahead. As they neared the village, the child could see many other footpaths full of throngs converging to the whirlpool of the fair. Throngs means crowd. Converging means meeting, and whirlpool is a swirl. So this line means that there was a crowd, there were many people who were meeting together in that whirlpool or in that mass of fair, in that swirl of fair, and felt at once repelled and fascinated by the confusion of the world he was entering. A sweetmeat seller hawked. Sweetmeat seller is a person who sells sweets. Gulab jamun, rasgulla, barfi, jalebi at the corner of the entrance, and a crowd pressed round his counter at the foot of an architecture of many coloured sweets decorated with leaves of silver and gold. The child stared open-eyed and his mouth watered for the barfi that was his favourite sweet. "I want that barfi," he slowly murmured, but he half knew as he begged that his plea would not be heeded. Plea means request, and heeded means attended to. Because his parents would say he was greedy, so without waiting for an answer, he moved on. A flower seller hawked a garland of gulmohar, a garland of gulmohar. Gulmohar is a kind of flower. The child seemed irresistibly drawn. He went towards the basket where the flowers lay heaped and half murmured, "I want that garland." But he well knew his parents would refuse to buy him those flowers because they would say that they were cheap. So, without waiting for an answer, he moved on. A man stood holding a pole with yellow, red, green, and purple balloons flying from it. The child was simply carried away by the rainbow glory of their silken colors. Silken means silk-like. And he was filled with an overwhelming desire to possess them all. Overwhelming means in great amount. But he well knew his parents would never buy him the balloons because they would say he was too old to play with such toys. So he walked on farther. So as the family was about to reach the fair, the child saw huge crowds of people walking from all directions towards the fair. The dense crowd did scare him, and he stepped back for a while. But then the next moment he got attracted to that mind-boggling crowd of human beings or people. At the entrance of the fair, to one corner, there was this sweetmeat seller who was selling sweet. And he had various sweets like gulab jamun, rasgulla, barfi, jalebi. He was shouting to attract the customers, and the customers had also surrounded his counter. The boy's mouth watered when he sighted his favorite barfi. He expressed his desire to buy that barfi, but he knew that his request will not be accepted by his parents, and they would say that he was greedy for the barfi, and he walked further. The next stall was that of flower seller. He announced that he was selling garlands of gulmohar flowers. The child wanted them, but he again knew that the parents would refuse to buy him those flowers because they would say that they were cheap. Again, the boy walked ahead without expecting a reply from his parents. The next thing that the child came across was a balloon seller selling balloons of different colors. The boy was again attracted to the shiny colors of the balloons and wanted to have them all. But again, he knew that his parents would refuse because they would say that he was too old to play with them. So the child walked further with his parents. A snake charmer stood playing a flute to a snake which coiled itself in a basket. Its head raised in a graceful bend like the neck of a swan. While the music stole into its invisible ears like the gentle rippling of an invisible waterfall. Okay, now this line, its head raised in a graceful bend like the neck of a swan, is a simile where the snake's head is compared to the neck of a swan. Like the swan raises its head gracefully, in the same manner, the snake also raised its head. Another line, while the music stole into its invisible ears like the gentle rippling of an invisible waterfall. When the music of that flute went inside his ears, it was the way it went inside, it was compared like the music or the sound of a waterfall which was invisible. The sound of the waterfall is termed here like a gentle rippling sound. The child went towards the snake charmer, but knowing his parents had forbidden him to hear such coarse music as the snake charmer played, he proceeded farther. Forbidden means banned, and coarse means rough. There was a roundabout in full swing. Men, women, and children, carried away in a whirling motion, shrieked and cried with dizzy laughter. Shrieked means screamed. The child watched them intently. Intently means attentively. And then he made a bold request. I want to go on that roundabout, please, father, mother. There was no reply. He turned to look at his parents. They were not there, ahead of him. He turned to look on either side. They were not there. He looked behind. There was no sign of them. A full deep cry rose within his dry throat, and with a sudden jerk of his body, he ran from where he stood, crying in real fear. Mother, father! Tears rolled down from his eyes, hot and fierce. Fierce means violent. His flushed face was convulsed with fear. Convulsed means shaken. Panic-stricken, he ran to one side first, then to the other. Panic-stricken means full of panic. Hither and thither. Hither and thither means in a disorganized way or manner. In all directions, knowing not where to go, mother, father, he wailed. Wailed means cried. His yellow turban came untied and his clothes became muddy. So while this family was roaming in the fair, the next thing that came across was a snake charmer who was playing a flute, and the snake was twisting its neck to the music. The snake's neck is compared to the neck of a swan, and also the music is compared to the effect of a waterfall which was created in it. The boy walked towards the snake charmer, but as his parents had warned him to remain away from the unpleasant music played by such men, he walked further. Then he saw the roundabout swing. It was full of men, women, and children who were enjoying the ride. The boy watched the people on the roundabout and then, with a lot of courage, expressed or asked about his desire to go on the roundabout. When his parents did not reply, he turned towards them. He saw that they were nowhere around. He looked around here, there, in every direction, but he could not find his parents. The boy cried loudly, jerked his body. He ran here and there, calling out for his parents. He was so full of fear, and tears started rolling down his cheeks. As he wailed, as he cried and ran around, his turban opened and his clothes became muddy. Having run to and fro in a rage of running for a while, he stood defeated, his cries suppressed into sobs. At little distances on the green grass, he could see, through his filmy eyes, men and women talking. He tried to look intently among the patches of bright yellow clothes, but there was no sign of his father and mother among these people who seemed to laugh and talk just for the sake of laughing and talking. He ran quickly again, this time to the shrine to which people seemed to be crowding. Shrine is a temple. Every little inch of space here was congested with men. But he ran through the people's legs, his little sob lingering. Mother, father. Near the entrance to the temple, however, the crowd became very thick. Men jostled each other. Jostled means pushed. Heavy men with flashing, murderous eyes and hefty shoulders. Hefty means heavy. The poor child struggled to thrust away between their feet. Thrust means moved forward, but knocked to and fro by their brutal movements. Brutal means violent. He might have been trampled underfoot. Trampled means crushed. Had he not shrieked at the highest pitch of his voice, "Father, mother!" A man in the surging crowd, surging means rushing, heard his cry and stooping with great difficulty, stooping means bending, lifted him up in his arms. So when the boy tried to search for his parents for a while, he gave up. And then his loud cries turned into mild sobs. He saw some people standing and talking and tried to find his parents among them. But he did not. The laughter and talks of the people seemed meaningless for the child. He was simply searching for his parents. Then the boy ran towards a temple which was crowded with people. There were men who were hefty, who were heavy, and he ran through the legs of those men calling out for his parents. But the crowd was pushing each other so violently that the boy got scared. Those strong men were looking at each other with murderous eyes and pushed each other with their strong and big shoulders. The boy could have been crushed under the feet of these hefty men or heavy men had he not cried in that crowd. And then his cries were heard by a man in the crowd who gently lifted the child. "How did you get here, child? Whose baby are you?" the man asked as he steered clear of the mass. Steered means moved ahead. The child wept more bitterly than ever now and only cried, "I want my mother, I want my father." The man tried to soothe him by taking him to the roundabout. Soothe means relax. "Will you have a ride on the horse?" he gently asked as he approached the ring. The child's throat tore into a thousand shrill sobs and he only shouted, "I want my mother, I want my father." The man headed towards the place where the snake charmer still played on the flute to the swaying cobra. Swaying means moving. "Listen to that nice music, child," he pleaded. But the child shut his ears with his fingers and shouted his double-pitched strain, "I want my mother, I want my father." Double-pitched strain means with a lot of force. The man took him near the balloons, thinking the bright colors of the balloons would distract the child's attention and quieten him. "Would you like a rainbow-colored balloon?" he persuasively asked. Persuasively means in a convincing manner. The child turned his eyes from the flying balloons and just sobbed, "I want my mother, I want my father." The man, still trying to make the child happy, bore him to the gate where the flower seller sat. "Look, can you smell those nice flowers, child? Would you like a garland to put around your neck?" So this man who caught hold of the child was a very gentle and a sober person, a very kind-hearted man. He tried to relax the child by showing him all those distractions which the child had earlier or he desired to have earlier. The man first tried to relax the child by taking him to a roundabout swing. He offered him the ride, but the child screamed. He refused because he only wanted his parents. Then the man started walking back to the same route which the child had taken. So he took the child to the snake charmer and he asked him to listen to that nice music. The child shut his ears with his fingers and he refused to listen because he wanted only his parents. Then the man took the child to the bright colored balloons, hoping that he might get cheered, he might be happy to see those balloons. But then again, the child refused to see those balloons because he wanted only his parents. The man then tried to make the child happy by taking him to the flower seller, the same flower seller which the child wanted to have a garland from. Now let's see what was the child's reply to this. The child turned his nose away from the basket and reiterated his sob. Reiterated means repeated. "I want my mother, I want my father." Thinking to humor his disconsolate charge by a gift of sweets. Disconsolate means unhappy. The man took him to the counter of the sweet shop. "What sweets would you like, child?" he asked. The child turned his face from the sweet shop and only sobbed, "I want my mother, I want my father." So, once again, the child refused to smell the flowers that he wanted to buy earlier because now his priority was to get his parents. And finally, the man took him to the sweetmeat seller and offered to buy some sweets for him. But still, the child did not want his favorite sweet but wanted his parents only. Now that we have finished reading an explanation of this chapter, let me quickly summarize it for you. A child with his parents goes to a fair. On the way to the fair, the child gets easily distracted by nature's beauties, like the butterflies, the dragonflies, the insects, the worms, the flowers, the cooing of the doves, everything. So this part tells us or shows us that the child was easily distracted or he would give in to the temptations of the world. When the parents and the child reached the fair, there was a big crowd there. But the child was always lagging behind because he was interested in the things which were displayed on the stalls. The first thing which he wanted was his favorite barfi from a sweet seller. But he knew his parents were very strict and they will not buy. They went ahead. Then he saw a flower seller. He wanted a garland. But then he did not say because he thought that his parents will tell them that it was such a cheap thing to possess. The next thing to which he was attracted was balloons. But again, he knew that his parents will not buy him balloons. So he walked farther with them. After that came a snake charmer. The snake charmer was playing his flute. But he knew that his parents will not allow him to hear that sound because it was very rough to hear. So they walked a little farther. And then he came across a roundabout. Now the child was very restless and he wanted to have some fun. So he asked boldly to his parents to have a ride on that roundabout. But unfortunately, he did not get an answer. He looked here and there, left and right. He did not see his parents. What had happened? The child had got lost in the fair. He was separated from his
parents, and then he started to cry. He saw there was a big crowd. He tried to search for his parents in the temple where people were pushing each other, you know, jostling and very ferociously moving ahead. Nobody even cared about the child who was between that crowd. But one man, a very kind-hearted person, picked up the child in his arms. He tried to pacify the child. He tried to show all those things which he was interested in. Every time the man asked the child about every distraction that he wanted to have, the child refused and only said that he wanted to go to his parents. So what do we learn from this story? We learn that we have a lot of desires in life, but we must learn what to curb and what to go for. The child also had a lot of desires. He also wished to have balloons, he wished to have sweets, a garland, a ride in the roundabout. He wanted to listen to the snake charmer's music or wanted to buy toys, but his parents were very strict and they did not let him buy. But the moment he was separated from his parents, he felt so fearful and insecure that all those things which he wanted earlier had no value for him. They all were useless for him, and the only thing he wanted thereafter was his parents and nothing else. Although the ending of the chapter is not given here, but we can always imagine a happy ending for the story. The child must have been reunited with his parents, maybe with the help of that kind-hearted man. So what is the moral of the story? The moral of the story is that we never value that person or that thing as long as we possess it. But the moment we lose that thing, or the moment we lose that person from our life, we appreciate or value that person. And that's how life is. This was the lesson which the child also understood when he was separated from his parents. Because before that, he used to feel his father as a tyrant, though mother was kind-hearted. But he knew that his parents will never give in to his desires or wishes or demands. But the moment he lost them, he understood the value. So we must learn to be hopeful at the end of the day always. That's all with the story, with the explanation, the reading part, the word meanings, etc. And now let's move on to the question answers. So I'll flash the question answers in front of you. Please note them down or go through them. And I'll see you again in my next video. Till then, take good care of yourself and love yourself.